Hey brothers and sisters, this is Brother Patrick trying to make a second video here and ask you to pray that I have more privacy space to make my videos and pray. God bless you guys. It's in my spirit to tell you guys and talk about Romans 8, chapter 8. In the beginning it says, now there is now the no more condemnation of those who are in Christ. Okay, there is now therefore no more condemnation of those who are in Christ Jesus, who walk according to the Spirit and not according to the flesh. Brothers and sisters, I've talked about this before. When you continue reading that text, and it's talking about walking according to the flesh is trying to follow the law, self-righteousness. If you're walking according to the Spirit, means you're walking according to the gospel and grace and following the Lord Jesus Christ and His Word and by His Spirit overcoming the world, the flesh, and the devil, death, hell, and the grave. So what I want to talk to you about in this second message that I'm making is about self-righteousness. Self-righteousness. There's there now no more condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, who walk according to the Spirit. Read that text. Go read those verses. It clearly tells you that walking according to the Spirit, of course, we're supposed to try not to sin. We're supposed to walk in sanctification and holiness. You guys know I teach that. But we're saved by following the gospel of grace. God gives grace to the humble, but He resists the proud. Now, that's the problem. All these condemning people. I made a video, brothers and sisters, about a year or two ago about that divorced people, God's not finished with you yet. And there's some old wacky, hate-filled truck driver who made a video saying I was a false prophet because I said that getting divorced is not the unforgivable sin. And it is not the unforgivable sin. So, you know, I've been meaning to do this for a long time. I think I mentioned it in the past. Anybody who has been divorced, who needs, you know, a place to fellowship, Church of the Firstborn, our online church, Joshua's Ministry, this YouTube channel is open to you because there is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. The only unforgivable sin is blasphemy of the Holy Spirit, which, by the way, this same guy, you know, doesn't believe in the gifts of the Spirit and mocks it and talks some junk about it in some of his other videos. It's that same old prideful spirit, self-righteousness, brothers and sisters. That's the problem with people. They're counting in their own righteousness, not the righteousness of Christ, for their salvation. Now, salvation is by faith. By grace are you saved through faith, not of your own, but a gift of God. Not by works, lest any man should boast. Now, I just mentioned in my last video about that we need to do work. I mentioned in there, I didn't use that word, but we should be thinking about the fact that when the rapture happens, do we have any rewards in heaven or not? Those are the works. The Bible, all in Ephesians, the text I quoted, Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8 and 9, where I said, by grace are you saved through faith, not of your own, but a gift of God, not by works, lest any man should boast. As I just quoted, all in that text it says we're not saved by our good works, but we're saved unto do good works. That's what I'm talking about. Those are two different things. So don't let all of these people, people that are not preachers, that are on YouTube making videos, condemning people, and then telling people they can do whatever they want, go to heaven. Those two different bookends of foolishness. Brothers and sisters, don't let anybody get you confused in the fact of once you're saved, the Lord predestined us to do good works to bring glory to His name. Let your light so shine before men that they may see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven, the Lord Jesus Christ said. So we want to do good works in keeping with repentance, as John the Baptist said, do works in keeping with repentance. So to repent means to turn from, change your ways, do something different. That's what repent means. You know, there's two types of repent. There's the Greek meaning of repent, which means change your mind, and the Hebrew meaning of repent, which means do something different. But they both go together. First, you have to bring every vain imagination into captivity. So if I said to you, hey, let's take a light one, smoking. Smoking is a sin because it's bad for you. You're destroying the body that God gave you, and you know it's bad for you. Or, you know, eating a cup of sugar when you got diabetes. You know that it could kill you or whatever. So let's just take those type of things. Self-destruction. So, you know, when you keep smoking every day and then I tell you, look, you're destroying your body, you're shortening your life, you're wasting money. You could take the money that you're buying cigarettes with and either, you know, use it for your family. You could give that to Joshua's ministry, the money you're spending on cigarettes. So that makes it a sin because it's just like throwing money down the toilet. At least when you smoke marijuana, you get high. When you drink beer, you get drunk. When you smoke cigarettes, what are you doing? I mean, it's nothing but killing you. I mean, there's not even a fleshly benefit. I mean, I don't even understand it. But you know, anyway, it's just a cultural thing that people think they're cool when they smoke when they're 16 years old. They get addicted and they keep doing it when they're the rest of their life. That's the truth about cigarettes. I used to smoke when I was a young person and quit when I was 21 because I started getting asthma. So I know what it's like to smoke. I know what it's like to quit. But I smoked about 5 years. Anyway, brothers and sisters, trying to be cool as a teenager. That's the message that the world sends about all these kind of things, about sex and all those things, drugs, whatever. Anyway, brothers and sisters, so I tell you, you know, you understand in your mind that smoking is bad for you. So you make a mental agreement. You ask the Lord to forgive you of self-destruction, of smoking. Ask the Lord to help you stop smoking. So you make a mental agreement that, you know, you repent in your mind. I know it's wrong. I want to quit. Help me, Lord, quit smoking. And then to physically turn from doing it, to repent physically in the Hebrew meaning, you turn away from what you've been doing. You change directions. So you start saying, okay, I'm going to, you know, I've been smoking, you know, a pack and a half, 30 cigarettes a day, and now I'm gonna taper off. So you smoke 29 the next day, 28 the next day, 27, whatever. Or you quit cold turkey, or you quit over 6 months, whatever it takes. Now that is repentance, brothers and sisters. But as an example, if you killed somebody, okay, there's lots of preachers, there's lots of people, there's many preachers I've heard and met and seen on television and all that. They were killed people, they were mafia. They were killers. They got saved. They became a preacher. Now they can't bring those people back from the dead. They are perpetually, the person is dead. It can't be undone. It cannot be undone. The damage is done. They repent from it, but they can't undo it. And they just don't kill no more people and they go on with their lives. Now divorce. Let's just say that two people are divorced and then you remarried and they remarried. Then you have kids, blah, blah, blah. You go on with your life. And then someone's trying to tell you that both of you are supposed to divorce from your new husband and wife, then go back to your first husband and wife, destroying two more homes. This is an example of something that is just, you know, it's you cannot undo some things. Now, if two people are divorced and neither one of them are remarried, they don't have any kids, you know, whatever, no kids with anybody else and all that, and they're both single, yeah, then they can try to reconcile. Every situation is different, brothers and sisters. Every situation is different. If it's possible to reconcile, yes, that's what you do. But you're talking about throwing gas on the fire and disrupting the whole, doing it all over again. Now, this is never God's intent to destroy more people for someone's benefit like that. God does not operate like that. I will say this. When you repent, you do the best you can to reconcile. In other words, as another example, suppose you, you know, you lied to somebody or you stole something. Yeah, and then if it's possible and the Lord leads you, yeah, you tell that person you're sorry. You apologize. You return it. Not every situation is like that. Sometimes the Lord leads you to do it. It depends on what you're talking about. You know, there's people who've committed crimes and then the Lord wants them to repent of it. Sometimes the Lord tells them to turn themselves in and the Lord wants them to receive punishment for that. Sometimes the Lord doesn't tell them, oh, go back, what, you know, you stole something from the grocery store 20 years ago, go in there and turn yourself in and then be prosecuted for, which they probably wouldn't do, it's probably statute of limitations, shoplifting, I don't know, whatever, some cigarettes, as an example, teenager might do something like that. Steal some cigarettes or candy from the store 20 years ago. You know, it depends. Every situation is different, brothers and sisters. There's no cookie cutter thing of doing all of these details of everybody's situation. And that's why God made, as it says in Ephesians chapter 4, he gave some pastors, or some apostles, some prophets, some pastors, some teachers, some evangelists, for the perfecting of the saints. It goes on and on until we come together to one new man. Ephesians chapter 4, starting at verse 11. So don't, that's what I'm saying. The biggest mistake people make is going on YouTube and getting their advice from truck drivers on YouTube. Getting their advice, there's, you know, I don't know how many people have messaged me that some wacko on YouTube or Facebook who you know is not a preacher, they didn't go to Bible school, that you don't necessarily have to go to Bible school, they just got saved last week, they're on going on there on Facebook telling people, oh, if you got divorced 10 years ago you're going to hell, you can't be saved, all kinds of things that people talk to me about and ask me about. That's why I know lots of you are on YouTube and you don't go to church. Organized religion, the churches are falling away, we know all that. And I thank God. That's why God put some pastors on YouTube, people you can message and ask questions to. Now, no people agree on every single little doctrine of every little thing. Okay, and we all have different opinions, but I would advise you, if you don't go to church, to go on YouTube and find you someone who is an ordained minister, okay, who agrees basically with what you do. It's just like a different denomination. If you don't believe in the rapture, you might not be watching my videos, but if you were, you can find you somebody that's a preacher that doesn't believe in the rapture or whatever it is that you know, you can talk to them if you want to remain like a Baptist. There's Baptist preachers that you can find on YouTube and talk to them about the and doctrine that you can understand that you believe in and want to line up with. I mean, that's why I believe ultimately God allowed different denominations. You know, some people really want to be close with the Lord. They want to be in holiness. They want to be in sanctification. They want to speak in tongues and all that. Hey, God made those Pentecostal denominations, Assemblies of God, Church of God, etc. And then there's those who want to be further away from God and be in kind of a ceremonial type of ominous, dominus type of stuff. That's why the Lord allows us, these Protestant denominations and all this, big cathedrals and all these pipe organs and all of this solemn. But for me, as some of that solemn stuff, it's really just self-righteousness and it's an outward appearance of religious spirit. It's a form of godliness, but they deny the power thereof. I mean, that's my observation and my opinion and my belief about those kind of religious ceremonies and stuff, brothers and sisters. Anyway, I wanted to come on here and tell you guys, the pastoral advice I can give you is don't take your pastoral advice from truck drivers and whatnot and et cetera on YouTube. Don't listen to some wackos that are messaging you on Facebook telling you're going to go to hell if you've been divorced and tell you you're going to go to hell. If you've been a homosexual in the past and you've come out of it, you're still going to hell, whatever. All kinds of wacky stuff that I've heard that people's been saying. Brothers and sisters, you need to have someone, if you're not sure, this is how it works. Everything that we receive from God is by faith. Okay? As Paul says, if it's sin to you and you don't have the faith to believe it's not sin, then it is sin for you. In other words, people that believe if I eat pork, it's a sin, and you don't have the faith to believe we're set free from the law and that I can eat pork, then it is a sin for you, Paul tells us, Romans chapter 14. So you are sinning if you believe. I mean, this is how it works. It's all by faith. When you believe, Paul tells us in Romans chapter 14, if you believe it's sin, it is sin. Some people believe, they can. It says do all things to the glory of God. So you believe you can drink a glass of wine because a little wine is good for the stomach, and you're standing on the word and you drink a glass of wine, there's no condemnation in you. But like for me, as a pastor, I want to, not give any, the Bible says, give no appearance of evil. So for me as a pastor, I'm a teetotaler, as they call it. I don't drink at all because I'm a pastor. If I wasn't a pastor, I might drink a glass of wine. Maybe. I don't say I would. I might drink some little wine that's good for the stomach or whatever. That's true. That's what the Bible says. But for me, I'm a teetotaler. So for me to drink, it would be a sin. Because that's my faith, that I shouldn't drink at all because I'm a pastor. That's my own. So when it really comes down to it, brothers and sisters, all of these things are interpretation of your own faith, your own walk with God, and has the Spirit lead you. Now, that's clearly what the Bible teaches. Now, I don't care one second what a truck driver might say about me or some guy that says he had a stigmata and a special revelation from God that you have to, do what he did to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. It's not speaking in tongues, but it's having a stigmata and a vision of Jesus that he had. Because my Bible says, the verse I started with, there is there now no more, and therefore no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. And you know what I can say about the United States, brothers and sisters? Last time I was here and this time, and the Lord has given me the wisdom to see it clearly. It's a spirit of condemnation that's on America. That's why all these people on there and saying, and it's true, there's lots of falling away in the American church, and America is getting bad. But let me tell you something. The devil wants us to be pessimistic. The devil wants us to be saying, hey, America's going to hell. The world's going to hell. We need the rapture right now. Of course we want the rapture to come. Of course there's a great falling away. But Paul said, and I mentioned Paul again because he wrote most of the New Testament. You exclude the Gospels and the book of Acts. He wrote 2/3 of the New Testament. Think on things, good things, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, he says like 10 different things. Think on these things. So in other words, think on the good things and the positive things. That's what God wants us to do. In other words, like me, I'm in this hotel room, and I mentioned that because, my wife and son are here and we, it's just one room and a bathroom. I can't really do my study and all that. That is true. But on the good side is hey, I got electricity. You know what I'm saying? In the Philippines, electricity kept going out. You know, so at least here, by the grace of God, we haven't had any blackouts. You know, so I've got electricity. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, I can run the air conditioner here if it's hot, and I can run the heater if it's cold. And hey, thank the Lord I got that. I got a bed to sleep on. There's lots of the children from our feeding programs sleeping on the floor. They're sleeping on a piece of bamboo, you know, a little bamboo bed or on the floor. Lots of the people from our feeding program. And this is what I would say. I should have said this in the last video. When you go to sleep tonight and you keep imagining and trying to calculate the date of the rapture, what you're going to do when you see the Lord, instead of thinking about that, I ask you to think about what the Lord might say to you. Because the Bible says that, you know, we'll give an account for everything and that we'd be ashamed in the presence of the Lord. And if I look at 1 Corinthians chapter 3, it talks about our works. If they're just done in the flesh, they'll be burned up as hay and stubble. If they're done by the Spirit of God and for the purpose of God and the glory of God, it will be like a gold coming through the fire. It'll be refined and made into the crown that the Lord would give you to wear. Brothers and sisters, I ask you to think tonight about those kids who are sleeping on the ground and don't even know the gospel. Stop thinking about yourself and think about God's people and those little children. And as Jesus said, suffer little children to come unto me and forbid them not, for such is the kingdom of heaven. I ask you to think about all those kids in the world, not just the Philippines, around the world, even the United States, that don't have anything to eat. And, you know, consider these children and consider all the evilness in this world and stop thinking that, hey, let's escape. And let's think about, let's bring the kingdom of heaven to these people. I need to make a whole nother video and drive this in an individual video.